Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Cheryl Reynolds. I'm with the UC Statewide IPM program, and welcome to the UC Ag Expert Talk on using plant growth regulators in citrus. Peter Cassina will be running our polls and doing troubleshooting. And we are both working remotely from our homes, and hopefully our audio will hold out. And please note that today's webinar is targeted to growers and pest management professionals. Master gardeners can certainly benefit from participating, but the pest management methods presented, especially the pesticides, are not to be followed without a clear understanding of their legal use by homeowners. And also, just a special thank you to the Citrus Research Board for their support of this webinar series. Okay, so we're closing that out. And so now I'd like to introduce our speaker today. Dr. Ashraf E. Kiriami is the new director of the Lynn Cove Rec and also a UCCE specialist at UC Riverside. And today he's speaking on plant growth regulators in citrus. And so now we will pass this over to Ashraf so you can go ahead and share your slides.
Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Ashraf El Kiriami, and I'm UC Cooperative Extension Specialist in Horticulture for citrus, and also the director for Lynn Cove Research and Extension Center. So I'm glad to talk to you today about using the plant growth regulators in citrus. It is the very interesting topic for the citrus industry in California. And because, you know, right now we are looking for a very high quality products, and also we are looking to keep our orchard running efficiently despite all challenges we have, like the weather condition, the soil and everything, and the disease. So plant growth regulators, they are very good tools to use in the orchard, and you can optimize using them in the orchard and have a good productivity in our orchard. But you know, just sometimes you need to, we need to understand more about them. And the more you know about those plant growth regulators, the more efficient you'll use them in the orchard, and you get more benefits from them. So, today webinar, you know, I will cover some topics, but in 1 hour, you cannot cover everything about the plant growth regulators, as you know. Just, you know, I will give you some points that, you know, you need to take care of it. And probably if you need more reading and more studies about this, you can go and even if you have any question, you can call me or just write an email to me. My email, it's in the first slide, and it will be in the last slide as well. You're welcome to call me anytime, and I will be happy to answer you for any questions as much as I can. So probably, well, today I will cover some points to understand what is the plant growth regulators, from where we are coming, like why they are in the industry now, and the relation with the plant hormones that control lots of aspects in the plants, and also the different categories of the BGRs and how we can handle them, role of each BGR in some of the operations we are doing in the citrus orchard. So I will cover some topics, but definitely there is more and more of topics that we can, or issues that can be solved by using BGR. But you know, we're still studying those issues, and for sure you have to keep up to date on the scientific report that's produced by all universities all over the world, and keep reading those ones. And from the UC Extension side, you know, we'll try to keep you up to date on what is available, what is the knowledge available, and how you can use it in your orchard to cover all of this or solve your problems. So let's start from the beginning. Why plant growth regulators? Plant growth regulators are chemicals, but you know, it's a synthetic form of the plant hormones. So we discovered the hormones long time ago in the plants, and we discover some of them and the function of them. And then we try to find those in our industry or just manufacture them or synthetic them from different other organism or extracted them and get them ready to use in the orchard. That's where from they are coming. But if you look at the, if you want to understand exactly how to use the plant growth regulators, you have to go and study the hormones, the plant hormones. So the plant hormones are different from the plant growth regulators. Plant hormones are the natural form of those growth factors or growth regulators. They are inside the plants, produced by the plants, and they are organic compounds. They are very active at very low concentration. And they are essential for so many you know, physiological processes inside the plants, starting from seed germination until even like at ripening stage or post-harvest stage. So they are very essential to keep growing and also keep the fruits in a good shape. The good thing about those plant hormones, they are produced in one specific part in the plants. Each hormone is produced in one specific part and then translocated to any other parts of the plants. So they can move inside the plants to make their functioning. They have a specific function. Not all of them work in the same like process. Like say for example, the GA or gibberellins are involved in the seed germination. Other hormones like involved in fruit ripening, like ethylene, for example. So each one has a specific function. Some of them they are induced by after stress, like acetic acid, for example. But by the end, they will act together. Some of them act against each other. Some of them they act together to complete the function of one hormone. We have five classical hormones. Those are like the main very old hormones that we discovered them. And then those are like auxin, cytokinin, gibberellin, abscisic acid, and ethylene. So those are the five classical hormones that we know. Most of us know those hormones. We studied them at the school and we some of us using them in the orchard already. Just to give you some just refreshing background about the auxin, it's mainly in the meristems and embryos in the seeds. And this hormone stimulates the stem elongation, like expansion of the cell, and also can delay the ripening and delay abscission. And then the second one is the cytokinin. Cytokinin, that's what they call it, the green revolution happened that when, you know, that's involved in delaying the ripening and the senescence of any tissues. Can also use to increase the fruit set. And the main function also is to increase the cell division. So it's involved in the cell division and root growth. And it mainly it is produced in the roots. Gibberellins or gibberellic acid, those are a big group of gibberellic acids, and we have around 80 of them now, but not all of them are active. Some of them, they are like intermediate components or precursors. Most of the GA we use in our orchard, the GA3, GA4 and 7, those are the most active ones, but we have around 80 of them. Again, those are produced in embryos, meristems, and they promote cell elongation and division also. So that's promote the growth by expansion of the cells. The other hormone is the abscisic acid. Abscisic acid is produced mainly under stress condition. Like so many of us using like the deficit irrigation or under drought condition, that induced abscisic acid inside the plants. And that's why we call them like, thus abscisic acid is the stress hormone. And this hormone is involved in the stomatal closure and inhibit the growth and promote dormancy also when, in some trees and some plants, and when they go in the winter, that's associated with high acetic acid content also. But also we use it in some other crops to improve the color. Ethylene, it's the only gas hormone. The previous four, they are liquid hormones, or they are involved in liquid, but the ethylene, it's more the gas hormone, the only gas hormone. And we call it the ripening hormone also because it's involved in fruit ripening. So like, as we will see in the slides, that it's produced during the ripening of the fruits and it control the ripening. If you can control the ethylene, you can control the ripening of some fruits and also promote senescence. So those are the five hormones that, you know, classical hormones that we know they are exist, and most of us, they know already those hormones. Now, know a little bit about them. And also, in this talk, I would like to introduce for you also up-to-date information about the hormones and what is the latest information we have about the different hormones, because people keep working at research institutions and universities and everywhere to find more hormones so we can understand exactly what is going on inside the plants, how we can use. If you can understand those hormones and what the function of those hormones, so you can control the plants. And if you can control it, you will be able to produce more crops with higher quality. That is the whole goal, is to produce more crops to feed the nations and also with higher quality. So one of those new hormones, they call it the brazinostroid. Brazinostroid, those are like defined as the sixth plant hormones, like after the five classical hormone. They are detected now in leaves, stems, roots, flower, everywhere. They play a role in adaptation to environmental stresses. And it also, some studies about those hormones, but it's still not registered for citrus in California or anywhere. But you know, just for your information, when you hear about those brassinostroids, those are kind of involved in tolerance to adaptation to environmental stresses. So still we're doing work on this, and other people in Florida, they are doing work on this brassinostroid. And even, you know, all of us know the HLB, and some studies suggest that they are involved there. So they're still working, people still working on those hormones and try to understand better how we can use them. The other one is salicylic acid. Salicylic acid is mainly involved in the systemic acute resistance. That's when you have infection in one part of the plants, and that's generate like kind of tolerance or resistance in another part of the plants. And they found that this abscisic acid, it's involved in there and improve the tolerance too and the abiotic stresses. So we still wouldn't have registration for this in California. Some other states like Florida, they might have salicylic acid registration, but under California condition, we don't have registration for this one yet. Jasmonate or jasmonic acid, those are lipid-based stress hormones also. They are involved in the adaptation to the biotic and the abiotic stress condition. And then also those are like inhibitors. They so inhibit the seedlings and they try to, make the plants more adapted to stress condition. The most recent study about this, jasmonate, I've read one paper about the involvement of the jasmonic acid or jasmonate on the ACB, the Asian citrus psyllid aggregation or population surround the trees. So that is something, I mean, people working on this and we're trying to understand how those hormones can be used in the orchard to improve the tolerance to or reduce the population or the aggregation of the ACP, the Asian citrus psyllid in the orchard, because, you know, as you know, all of us know that, you know, GLB, it's a dangerous disease for us here in California. We're trying to find a way to stop it here in California. So that can be something, I mean, people are still working on this and trying to understand what is the relation and how we can use it in this. Strigolactones are kind of hormones. Also, they are new hormones. They are produced in the roots. And they are produced from the roots to improve the interaction with the soil microbiomes like mycorrhizae. So what happened that the mycorrhizae lives with the plants in a symbiotic way. So just the fungal provide the trees with the phosphate and nitrate and the nutrition. At the same time, the plants provide the fungus with the carbon and nitrogen metabolites, so like kind of energy and amino acid. So there's some kind of relation, and the plants like this relation and produce those hormones to improve or keep this relation happening. So there's no too much studies on this trigolactones, but still people working also on this and try to understand how we can use those hormones. Because, you know, again, going back to HLB, that, you know, if you have a good root system, you'll be able to tolerate, or the trees will be able to tolerate the HLB. So people or scientists from all over the world were trying to understand how root health affect the tolerance to this disease. And that is one of the hormones that's involved in the root health and the interaction with the soil microbiome. So, you know, those plant hormones are classified in two major groups. One group that promote the growth, and the other group that inhibit the growth. So the what we call it growth promoters, like cytokine and gibberellic acid and the auxin at low concentration, those improve the cell division, the cell expansion, and the cell wall structure. So the cell grow better and more cells will be there. So that those are the growth promoters. Growth retardants or inhibitors, those like abscisic acid and the ethylene, those are the two inhibitors. And usually those abscisic acid is a stress hormone. As I said, it's still used by stress. And ethylene, it's on the, in the fruits, and it, we call it the ripening hormones. Because, you know, we don't need growth right now. We just need other physiological process that induces the ripening, not improving the size or the cell division. For the cell division or the like the promoters, like GE and cytokinin, we have two hormones, the GE, which is gibberellic acid, and cytokinin. Both of them, they promote the growth of the cell or the tissues, but you know, their function, actual function is different. The gibberellic acid, it's more involved in the cell elongation and expansion. So it can increase the size of the cell. So when you increase the size of the cell, you get increased, you got to increase the size of the fruits as well. And then that was first discovered by, you know, when you grow the seedlings in the dark, they got taller, and that is how they discovered the involvement of GE in the cell elongation or cell expansion. But also it can increase the cell division, but not the main function of the GE. Like when you see here on the top image here, like that is the cytokinin when they increase the cell or the tissue size or the fruit size, by increasing the cell division. So cytokinin more involved in the cell division rather than the cell elongation. The GE is doing the same thing, but by cell elongation or expansion. So these two function like inside the cell that leads to increase the fruit size. For citrus, we have more used for GE and orchid rather than the cytokinin. Because I think it's not registered yet in Citrus. Okay, how it can increase the size? We increase the size by using those hormones at the early stage. Like when you, as I said in the beginning, when you understand this process, you use the BGR more efficiently in the orchard. So looking at the food growth from the beginning after bloom until full fruit maturation, you can see that, you know, we have three stages. Stage one, when the cell division start like increasing the cell division and the fruits will have more number of cells. And then following this stage, those cells start to expand and get larger and larger in size until they form the full mature fruits. And then by here, by the end of this stage two, the fruits start to mature or get more color, more sugar and everything. And if you can see here that during stage one and stage two, it's mainly growth promoters like auxin, GA and cytokines are involved in this. So basically when in the orchard, if you want to increase the size, you have to work on these two stages here, stage one and stage two. You don't need to go and wait until stage three to increase the size. If you wait until stage three, you miss the stage, and in this case, you don't have a good effect in this. Stage three, it's more involved other hormones, like I said, abscisic acid and ethylene, and those hormones lead to, for example, changing the carbohydrates to sugar, so the fruits will get more sweeter, and the color from green to yellow or orange, so they can be good for marketing. So at later stage, the stage three, just changing it, I can call it biochemistry changes in the fruits, converting all these big components like starch and then polysaccharides into monosaccharides or like to form the sweetness of the fruits, the flavor, for example, also induced at this stage, as we'll see later on. So if you want to increase the size, you have to start in the beginning. That's how we use our knowledge from the hormones to optimize the use of the plant growth regulators in the citrus orchard. Like, you know, talking about the ripening or the maturation, there's some other fruits, like, you know, the ethylene involved in those fruits, like very, very, very well, and then the ripening of those fruits, depending on the ethylene, like here in the tomatoes, apples, it's the same thing. For citrus, they are what we call them non-climacteric fruits. They are not depending on ethylene to change it from like immature to mature fruits. However, there's some indicator that, you know, it might be involved in ethylene, might be involved in the transition from the green to yellow or orange fruits. Those non-climacteric fruits, if you cut them like green, they will stay green. If you pick them from the tree green, they will stay green. They don't change. While, you know, for example, the climacteric fruit like banana, for example, if you buy green banana from the store and you leave it in the kitchen for a few days, that will turn into yellow banana. That's because of the ethylene skin being produced by the fruits. While in the non-climacteric fruits like the grapes and citrus, they stay green. That's why sometimes we harvest the green fruits and they treat it with ethylene as a gas to change the color. So that is one of the things that we need to understand when we harvest the citrus. Like, you know, they may be suitable for eating and have a good eating quality, but the color is not good. So in this case, you can harvest them and treat them with ethylene gas and improve the color. Okay, next slide. Okay, we were talking about the ethylene and how ethylene it's involved in the citrus as a non-climacteric fruit that like you can use it after post-harvest or after harvest to degreening fruits or make it yellow or orange color. But it also ethylene, people studied ethylene for years and years and years. It's become like a model for other hormones also. But it, what I wanna show you here that, you know, how those hormones is working inside the plants. Problem that, you know, the hormones, like they have what we call it the receptors inside the plants, in the plant cell. So after applying or producing by the plants, they go here in the cell membrane and attach to those receptors. And those receptors generate like a signal. It's like pulse, like power pulse signals. And those signals, they go in, inside the cells and activate some genes. And those genes produce some proteins, and the proteins produce enzymes, and the enzymes start to working. For example, as I said, you know, for the stage three, when the fruits start to change in the aroma or the sugar, those are enzymes here that make these changes. So it's coming from the hormone that goes inside the cells and the nucleus and activates some genes, and those genes activate the enzymes, and the enzymes make this function, like transform all polysaccharides and carbohydrates into simple sugar so we can taste it, or produce more color so you can see more coloration, or produce the aroma in some fruits. So that is the model for how this hormone it's working. And if this model become like true also in other hormones. Something also I need to talk to you about it, like, as I said, you know, all hormones, they work together, interact together. Some of them, they antagonist each other, and some they work together. Like here, you see that is ethylene antagonist the auxin, like this, the dashed one is the antagonistic, and the abscisic acid increasing the auxin, and auxin can increase the, or promote the effect of the GA. We use this knowledge sometimes in the orchard to mix GA, for example, with auxin, or GA with cytokine, to get more effective of the or more effective of the BGRs in the orchard, as we'll see later. But some of them say, for example, if you add the abscisic acid to GA or has some condition that increase the abscisic acid, like drought, for example, if you have a drought and add more GA, the probability antagonist each other, they just zero each other, so you don't have any effect. So sometimes when you apply those BGRs in the orchard, you get no effect or less effect. Look at this, look at how they interact, how our culture practice also can produce one of the other hormone that can inhibit or promote what we are spraying in the orchard. So just you need to think big and think about the whole picture of those hormones. The plant hormones also, not all of them, they have commercial products, but auxin, like, you know, some of us know, they have commercial products of auxin, like the IBE and AE and 2,4-D also, those are the main ones. Cytokinins, they have those from kinetic and benzylaminoglycerin also, that's one of the cytokinin. As I said, gibberellic or gibberellins, they have the GS3 and GA4+4+7. Those are the most common two products. Abscisic acid, we have a product called Brutone also at the commercial, but it's not registered for citrus, but for other crops. Ethylene, we have the acephone, and the, I think there's some studies about the acephone and try to register it in citrus also. As I said, you know, when you use hormones or the BGRs, you are manipulating the inside, the internal or endogenous hormones inside the cells. So be careful about this. When we manipulate those hormones, we make changes. And some of those changes, if they are in the reasonable range, will be okay with the plants to grow and give us what we need. But sometimes if you use very high concentration or go to the extreme end, that may damage the cell and you don't get good results. You get like negative effect. So as we all know, plant growth regulators are regulated by the BBR, and they follow the same guidelines as best sites. So they follow under the best site. So when we handle them, when we apply them, you have to follow the labels and read the labels, not one time, just read it twice. And also avoid the drift, because some other crops, they are very, very sensitive to those hormones or BGRs. So it can cause a lot of damage in the orchard. Now I want to show you some of the issues that we can use the BGR for in the citrus orchard, and it can be helpful, but you know, to be up to date, look at the label, look at the commercial names of those products and see if we can use it and how we can use it. Okay, so those are just some hints, and you can, if you need more information about this, look at the commercial products and read the label and read the guidelines. The UC IBM also website has some information about those. One of the problem in the fruit like quality before harvest, the crazing or the buffness, as you can see here, because the two layers of the rind grow differently, so you can see some of buffness here. That is very common in navel orange and in some other mandarins. And you can prevent those by using the GA. As we said, you know, the GA involved in the cell expansion. So you get some elasticity when you apply the GA. That date of application and the rate of application should be on the in the label of those products. There's so many products in the market. So that is one of the main use for GA in the orchard. Another fruit disorder, the pre-harvest disorder in mandarin, that's, I'm working on this disorder, like in Satsuma, for example, after the rain, you get some stain, like we see here, the browning of the rain. And we did some work on this and last season, and we're gonna try to do some work this season again. But you know, we found that when you apply GE or 2,4-D, that can help the rind to be more healthier and more just delaying the senescence or of the rind. So the rind will be more tolerant to those kind of wetting during the winter. Those are just some guidelines. Also, you can use it, but you know, you have to go back to the label and read the label again and just see what follow the guidelines. The only drawback of this application, the 20 ppm part per million GA on mandarins, that you know, we noticed some delaying in the ripening. That is the answer of some question. The question was answered before. Like here, we did this treatment in different crops, different varieties like Tango, W. Mycot, Beige, and Satsuma. And you can see some delay in the ripening. And also, but we prevented completely the damage caused by the rain. So this season, we are trying to do more work on this and try to drop the rate from 20 ppm to 10 ppm and see if we can help the rind to stay healthy and at the same time get the same color. But sometimes it's good if you can delay the ripening for 1 month or so, you can manage the market. But that is the latest information on those varieties, and we'll keep working on those ones. Okay, I want to talk about this one just in the few minutes left. The PGR also, alternate bearing, it's a big issue on citrus, and where you have the 1 year on and 1 year off. 1 year on, you have lots of fruits and small fruits, and 1 year off, you have nothing on the trees. that's common in some varieties and crops in the citrus. Some people, they used it to use some PGR to try to reduce this alternate bearing. But I think it's hard to eliminate it completely by the BGR because there's so many factors involved in this alternate bearing. But at least in the heavy year or the on year, when you have a heavy crop, you may just remove some of the crop. Remove it by, you know, you can use naphthalene acetic acid, which is auxin in EAA, to reduce some of those fruits. Just try to use it very carefully, especially we are in the Southern Valley, and in California we have a very high temperature. And it also, as I said, you know, when you use those BGR, be careful about the timing of the day, the timing of the year you are using those BGRs. So maybe you will have more excessive thinning or removing of those fruits when you apply it in when you apply it in during the high temperature of the day. That's why usually we advise the people to apply the BGR by the end of the day when temperature is cooling down a little bit, so they stay a little bit longer on the leaves and the fruits, and you have more effect. Also, don't use the dust any or the auxin on the unhealthy trees. You know, just don't exhaust that, like, you know, just don't use all the power or the energy from the trees to go through this BGR pathway. It's like, you know, when you have an old car and driving the old car, don't go at 100 miles per hour. You know, you have to be reasonable when you use the BGR. Don't use it in very weak and healthy trees. And also increase the fruit set by GE. That's a very common one now in some of the seeded one, like the WMR code mandarin, for example. You can use the GE to improve the fruit set and have seedless fruits. And that, in this case, they cover it with the screens and to prevent the bees from cross-pollinated them, the trees. And then before that, you have to apply for the GE to get this seedless fruits. You have to look at the label and see what is the red and what is for your crop. 2,4-D to reduce the drop. Again, we can use the 2,4-D to reduce the pre-harvest fruit drop. Again, depends on the crop, the variety also, the geographical area you are in, and the temperature, and where the flowering is happening. In the Bay Area or the coastal area, lemon, they produce more flushes, so that's a problem. You have two crops on the trees and you have to be very careful. Don't go very close to the flowering. So you have to be very reasonable where exactly when you can apply this 2,4-D to reduce the fruit drop. So don't reduce the fruit drop of this year and remove all the crop of the following year. Again, 2,4-D, you can use it also to increase the size. How we can use the same product for different purpose? By, if you look at the concentration you are using in the reduce the fruit drop, it's not the same concentration you are using for the fruit size. So when you read the label, be very careful and look at those exactly the purpose you are doing. Another used for the NAA or the auxin is to remove the suckering or prevent the suckering in some trees. When you cut the trees to working the tree or grafting, you need to paint them with this NAA, and for sure that's higher concentration than NAA we use for fruit set. If you look at here, that's 500 to 1500 milligrams per liter, which is very high. So I want to give you something that's just to think about it when you do the when you use the BGRE in the citrus orchard, as I said, you know, avoid spray drift. That is a very big, big issue, especially if you have mixed crops like go close by, like grapes are very, very sensitive to auxin, and if you spray and have drift on the grapes, that will destroy the crop. As I said, don't apply it on the healthy or young trees. Consider the crop and the variety also. Geographical area, it's very important. Some areas, they are cooler than the others, and you have to keep this in mind. The right physiological stage also is something you need to look at it. Don't look at the dates, like the question we had it before. Don't look at the dates, like May or June or July. No, look at the physiological stage where they are. If you don't know, just contact me, like I'll guide you through those physiological stages. Respect the rate, don't go over rate, over the, you know, just it's legal to go over the label. But you know, be reasonable. And also if you don't know the good rate to use, just try it in a small area of your orchard and you'll be able to determine that's the good rate for you or not. Good display coverage, that's always a good thing to do it in the BGR. As I said, read the label twice, not only once. Good spray methods, try to calibrate the sprayers and use different spray techniques and see which one works for you, because it depends on the tree size and your orchard also. As I said, it's good to spray in the evening, so when it's cooling down, you know, and if you spray in the winter, choose warmer days. And also surfactant, it's another thing that you need to consider. It does increase, surfactant increase the efficiency of BGRs, but you know, be careful when you use very high concentration, that may cause some problem.
And there was just a clarification on the last one. So the someone was wanting to make sure that the 2,4-D is the same as the herbicide.
Okay, that's a good example of respecting the rate. 2,4-D can be used as growth promoters at low concentration, and when it goes to very high concentration, it can be herbicide. That's why we do before registration, all these companies, they do efficacy and phytotoxicity studies, and they have to submit it to the DPR to get approved, and they have to use different concentration and see what is the limit. So the same component, but different concentration. Any more questions?
All right. So the first one, there is a lot of concern on food allergies caused by modern agricultural practices. Do you think plant hormones and PGRs may contribute to that?
It's out of my area. And, you know, I don't think everything approved by DPR should be safe, you know, but you know, I cannot talk about this. I don't think it's involved in there. There's no any studies about the involvement of BGRs on the allergy. I haven't seen anything about this.
Okay, the next one, are there major restrictions for tank mixes with other sprays that may be done at the same time? Obviously the label must be considered for each, but anything of particular concern generally?
The main concern would be the pH. If you are mixing with some other material that has higher pH, like potassium hydroxide, for example, or something that over 8.5 pH, that may reduce the efficiency of the BGR.
Okay, the next one, will some of these PGRs affect pistachios if drift occurs?
I'm not a pistachio guy, but I think, it can affect any other crop.
Okay, do you have any recommendations for any good readings on PGRs?
You know, unfortunately, I like to read them, like the new studies. So probably there is some science, like, you know, you can Google using the BGRs in citrus orchard or in plants in general. If you wanna go, go for general reading. Don't be restricted to citrus, because, you know, studies in citrus, it's limited. Or any other crop, like specific crop, is limited. But, you know, just if you go for general reading, that's to give you more broad ideas about the BGRs and up-to-date information. And also, I'm working on putting a website at Linkov to collect all these data, like about citrus, up-to-date studies about citrus and literature that's available for free for the readers. So,
yeah. I may have a little plug-in here that UCIPM Pest Management Guidelines for Citrus include also chapter on plant growth regulators.
Yeah.
And these guidelines were revised last year, so the information there is pretty up to date.
Okay. Another question was, or are organics treated with PGRs?
It has to be approved by OMRI. If it is used for organic production, the BGR has to be approved by OMRI. And I think, I cannot tell you now, but I mean, if you go to OMRI website, you will be able to see the BGR that's certified organic. There's some of them certified organic, some they are not.
Okay, another one. Are any of the new hormones you mentioned in the process of having PGRs registered anytime soon?
I don't see them very soon, no. No.
Okay, well, I think that's all the questions we have. So thank you for presenting today, and thank you everybody for being on.
Thanks so much.
And we hope everybody has a good rest of your day.